Welcome on the first panel of this year's May Day School on my behalf as well. We are going to start off with a very hot political topic, I would say. In a certain sense, it's a continuation in spirit of last year's May Day School, which was dedicated to fascism. Last year, we opted for a more European-based approach, so this year we are geographically widening it. Acting from the same premise, which is how socioeconomic and political conditions contribute to a flourishing of retraditionalization of society and of rise of extremist politics. But at the same time, we do want to reject this general belief that the wider Middle Eastern, North African region is exclusively a hotbed of radical Islamist politics and a place of religious feuds which have been carrying on continuously ever since of the 7th century AD onwards. And also another stereotype that what the problem is a certain lack of good old Western liberal secularism, and that the universal solution would be just a simple application of this. To help us with this panel, with me are three guests. On my right is Giuseppe Acconcia, who has been particularly involved as a researcher and a journalist in the situation in Egypt, and also several other things. And to my left are two correspondents and commentators of Ljubljana's very own radio student, which are Aleš Mendiževac and Miha Turk. The first particularly interested in a state which does not really have much international recognition, but which, according to Aleš, definitely aspires to become one, which is the Islamic State. And Miha, who is particularly interested in Turkey and in Syria. We're going to start with Miha. The topic of his presentation is going to be jihad and secularization. Miha, more concretely, is a master student of philosophy and history. He works as a cultural worker and a journalist for a radio student. Particularly interested in Kurds in Turkey, the refugee crisis, and the political situation in Iraq. Also Greece, but that may be a topic for another time. Miha, the floor is yours.
Hello. So, I have the honor of to be the opening act of this year's May Day School. Now, in the introduction of the May Day School, it says the self, the first sentence, is the self-understanding of leftist emancipatory projects is still largely determined by the blueprint drawn somewhere at the outset of modernity in the early 19th century. Now, I don't know so much about self-understanding of leftist emancipatory projects, but in terms of Middle East, there's quite a few literal blueprints that still determine the geopolitical landscape, not to mention the implication it has on questions of identity and political strife. I will make now, let me say, a more general introduction, basing somewhere a bit in history in the early 19th and 20th century, while my colleagues, I think, will be more focused on the present. There's also, when it comes to blueprints, there's also the other reason why I will focus on the early 20th century. This year is the 100th anniversary of Sykes-Picot Agreement, the agreement that between the French and the French and British governments in the First World War, where they were declared their vision of Middle East after the First World War, which of course was open to the public in 1917 by Lenin. And this is not so much as this is not a nostalgic approach, but I think the Sykes-Picot is a very, very real fact of Middle Eastern politics, be it as a trauma, be it as a factor when you look at the geopolitical structure, which is still very much determined by this. Two or three months ago, I was in Sinjar Mountain, which was liberated from ISIS, which was conquered from ISIS by Kurdish soldiers, and I made a short interview with the Kurdish general, one of the Kurdish generals, Peshmerga generals, who led the offensive on Sinjar, the city that is now completely destroyed. Maybe 90% of the city was destroyed. And he made like a very formal conversation, and at the end, that he had a very long speech, very declarative. And he said, and he concluded the speech with, he said, even though the French and the British are now our allies, this spring we will conquer Mosul, and this will be the end of Sykes-Picot. And it was quite an eerie experience when I was right on the front line. And the front line is basically the same war as it is on the, it's the same technique and it's the same mentality and effect on morale. This was the First World War, the whole front line is 1,000 kilometers of trench and some no man's land, and the other side is position of ISIS, who in fact are also fighting against the Sykes-Picot agreement. If you see that famous video that was right after the emergence of Islamic State, you see that at the end of Sykes-Picot, and they throw down the border post between Syria and Iraq. But it's also very as a trauma, it's a very life topic, in the sense that everybody, when you talk about politics, they always return to this particular moment, this particular event, and what followed after that. So, to go back, not so much to Sykes-Picot, but the name of my presentation is Secularism and Jihad, is two extremes of forms of dealing with this trauma in recent history. Is of course secularism and jihad that do have their origins as a political tool in the early 19th century. Now, what I would like to at least do. So my attempt will first be to be quite empirical and to show in a few examples how these two strives of jihad or political Islam that evolved into political Islam and secularization are not so much an antithesis, but in many ways they also, jihad in a modern term, as a very modernistic concept, is in fact somewhat they're more interconnected and reflected. So at one point, but we'll get to that. So, So one of these claims, which I do think there's some basis in that, is that the idea of jihad that we now know in the present modern form was in fact was very present as a political category in the 19th century, but it was more as a preoccupation of the Western diplomats. There was a rebellion in India with the name of, which they also called jihad in the 19th century, and the British Empire and the French and the Russians, they made very, very big emphasis on this threat of uniting, if Islam, if the Islamic world would be possible to unite under one banner, under one concept, that this would be effectively the end of colonialism, as all the powers had quite substantial, including especially Russia, quite substantial Muslim minorities, Muslim parts. But what I wanted to say that it was a very fictitious threat, in the sense that in all the calls for jihad, when the caliph in traditional terms made the plea to go to rally for the anti-imperialist cause, it was always very particular, in the sense that it was always through some social strife, through some nationalist idea, but very, very particular in all of its. On the other side, secularism, when we come to the Middle East, I think the traditional or the normal the way how we look at secularization, I think it doesn't apply in terms of Ottoman Empire, as it is similar as it claims for this idea of jihad as a very cosmic, not a cosmic, but a very global force. Secularization was partly enforced by the Western powers on the Ottoman Empire, but not in the sense. So when we come to secularism in the Middle East, you have to look at this on two sides. One is this traditional tool as a striving of a certain part of civil society that tries to reform and liberalize its government and to minimize the role of religion. While in the case of Ottoman Turkey, this came as an outside condition that was enforced, but not so much on Ottoman society as such, but in different parts of, but on religious minorities, as religion in Ottoman Empire was the basic of class division and the very foundation of society as the whole population was divided, like administratively, legally, and also socially on religious aspects, circles to this military system. But the point I'm trying to get across is so much that the strive for secularization is this enlightened project of 19th century Europe. In fact, made the conditions for the what we now in modern terms, how ISIS understands jihad, in the sense that it completely, that only the strife of secularization completely made way or the foundation to completely. But I'm getting a bit ahead of myself. No, the point I'm trying to get across is the secularization is stupid. In fact, it was the strife for secularization was had almost the same maybe place as the IMF reforms. That now it meant economical liberalization of a certain classes, of certain religious classes. While the dominant Muslim part was untouched by reforms, which means like in the Ottoman Empire, only Greek citizens could get passports, could run some form of businesses, to open banks and so on. While the Muslim part had the official structure of government, of commerce and so on, but the commoners of the Muslim part were still much worse off in this structure, which in fact made grounds for this religious antagonism that we know now, but basically on economical, but its basis is of course in the economical level. But the point I'm really trying to make is, if I go back to Sykes-Picot and jihad, apparently this won't get through, is that when I was, that my work, I'm not a theoretician, but primarily as a journalist, when I was in the Middle East, my point was, if we go beyond the conspiracy theories, what is the point of, let's say, Israeli occupation of Palestine, and more so the American or the Western support of this occupation, if you go beyond conspiracy theories and all this aspects. And I think the root of this aspect is still in this fixation, 19th century fixation of diplomats of the 19th century with the threat of global jihad. So instead of having a united or the same, because the problem is, because of the united front of, I don't know how many, half a billion Muslims, you would have, you divide the Muslim world into three three points, three centers that become the centers of antagonism. So in Turkey you have Atatürk's Turkey, which is a very secular society, nominally. You have one tribe is in Palestine and in Syria, and the other one is in Saudi Arabia, which was conquered by Wahhabis. And Saudi Arabia by itself was never colonized, partly because of this fear, because the assumption was that if they do colonize Saudi Arabia, the Mecca and Medina, that that this would be a cause for a global jihad, as it was such a threat. But jihad as a threat was a very, but I'm trying to make a more non-theological, a very pragmatic, to show the way how it was related, how it was used in very pragmatic terms or it was perceived by diplomats and decision makers in the 20th century. One to me interesting aspect of this is actually the foundation of the Turkish Republic. And it's a very, in Turkey, this is a very strong point still in schools. It's Mustafa Kemal Gazi Atatürk. But also declared that when Atatürk, when he was still Mustafa Kemal, when he started his fight against his fight against the Greeks and the French and the Italians and the British that owned parts of his land, he declared his very own jihad, and he was Atatürk, the most secular leader in Middle Eastern or even in 20th century history, is in fact one of the most successful jihadists of all times. And with this prestige, and he was title of Ghazi, as a veteran of jihad, was given to him by the last caliph, and with this authority and this prestige and power that he gained through this act, he got the means to declare the first secular Middle Eastern country. But the point but the main point is with this. I try to do this, but I don't think I made myself very clear. Is that to drive this comparison between traditional Islam and this modern form of Islam, which is in fact a reaction to this secular meddling from outside sources, and it was quite declaratively always considered to be an outside source, even economically, as coming in terms of economic reforms, and it was very clearly imposed by an outside power. But with Atatürk's conquering of Turkey, he in fact did the jihad in this modern, very positivistic term of not as a fight for religion, but in this very ethnic cleansing type of a way, which is doesn't have so much of a theological basic, but it has this striving for unity and for two. And I think ISIS in that sense comes quite close in its aspect, because in the last in the 20th century there may be dozens of examples of people, of religious leaders declaring jihad for this and that other cause, like in Syria, Sultan al-Atrash, he declared a jihad for the principles of the French Republic to be imposed on the French mandate authorities in Sulaymaniyah, in Kurdistan, in northern Iraq. There was a Kurdish sheikh who declared his own jihad against the Kurdish against the British authorities for the Kurdish nation, but he had a Quran with the golden verses of the 13 Wilson's point. And my last point when it comes to Saizpiko, and this is basically, is maybe this might sound, and the emphasis on my presentation is that the secularism in this form has been imposed and perceived as a foreign imposition, and in order to, for any social strife, for any political strife, you go to all the political movements, they always you have to when they want to reliably identity on the least foreign element, you always come back to the religion, to the religious aspect on it, or in best case scenario, on this some sort of 19th century perception of identity, which is quite, I think it's something really true for the Kurds at the moment, who are very in this sense. But the point, the point I wanted to say, when it comes to Syria, when it comes to Syria, and it's maybe a very strong statement, but part of the problem is that that the Middle East was never properly colonized. That it, the Ottoman Empire was kept alive very artificially, and it was reforms were imposed from the outside, and the Middle East, in fact, did get divided after the First World War, but in the new era of Wilson's America and of Lenin's Soviet Union, this, and because of the experience of the First World War, colonialism in its open paternalistic form, this very patriarchal, very authoritarian form, was not so was not, how do we say, it's favorable or sanctioned. So the mandate of the mandates, which is the post World War I definition of a colony for the French and the British mandates for Syria and Iraq, are in itself they have all the aspects in function. They have all the aspects of a normal colony, except in its rhetoric. It was made, and I read the articles, the foundation articles of the Syrian mandate. It's very paternalistic. It talks about fatherly love and how it will help the Syrian nation to build itself on a secular foundation, and so as not to, so that feudal powers won't come to back to, won't come back, and so on. So declaratively, there's always the strive for, okay, you need the constitution, you need to secular this and that, but in reality, in execution, their whole aim was just to create a very, very divided rule in the sense of antagonizing one religion towards the other, to antagonize the minority against the majority. And because of this mandate, I mean, it's quite clear even now, or it was clear 10 years ago, you have in Afghanistan, you have the Syrians, you know, in Iraq, you have the Sunnis are the minority, and but you have a Sunni government, and in Syria, the Alevis and the Shiites are in power, which are, again, a minority. This is a directly result of this politics. And it's quite interesting that this Syrian revolt in the year 1925, this is the first modern war in this sense, the first time an urban center was bombarded from the air. It was Damascus, the first time gas was used against civilian population. But it was also the war that before the Spanish Civil War, it was the conflict of the era, in the sense that all the intelligentsia, all the intelligence of Europe was writing about the aspects of using gas against civilians. Partly because of this experience, they definitely forbid the use of poisonous gas in warfare. But now, in this, at least in my experience, where I talk with people, especially with French, this idea, and a French friend of mine told me that when it was this, when it was the Paris shooting, they had of course a lot of panels and a lot of too, but never has it been mentioned that Syria was in fact practically owned by French for 20, 23 years. I think the French left Syria because Churchill threatened them with an invasion, and they bombarded Damascus 4 or 5 times between. But to me, it's really fascinating that, and I'm not playing here the blame game or being moralistic in the sense, but just the fact that there is no consciousness or even awareness that France was present in the Middle East is just astonishing to me. So yeah, but two, and this is, okay, the last two, and I'm speaking about the French, is this point of secularism. The other part is that it's not so much secularism as, as I said, as a striving of civil society of Middle Eastern too. This colonial politics was more of a side effect of secular striving in France, and in this particular in France, as the colonial, or the striving to obtain influence and power in Syria was in many ways was a common factor in French political forces in landscape of the Second Republic, as France was the Catholic party, let me say, and the more secular stream in the French. What I want to say, that both sides of political aisle were very, it was this colonial, but it was also a point of unity that was necessary for the second French Republic to declare its separation of church and state and so on. But it was all that. That doesn't matter. Thank you.
Thank you, Micha. I would ask if there are any very quick top points of factual clarification that needs to be addressed immediately, because if not, we will move the whole discussion for all three correspondents to the end of the panel. Okay, in that case, we are now moving onwards to Giuseppe. And in terms of time, we are skipping ahead towards the Arab Spring and the uprisings. More particularly, the left-wing activism and social movements within it, and how this is connected with the wars in the Middle East. Giuseppe Concia, within a fairly impressive CV, I would like to emphasize that he is a graduate of an educational institution that is very dear to us here in Ljubljana, namely the School of Oriental and African Studies in London. He is a researcher and a media correspondent, specializing in North Africa and the Middle East, and an author of numerous publications directly connected with Egypt and the recent happenings in there. Giuseppe, the floor is yours.
Hello, thank you for having me here. And let's discuss about Arab uprisings and workers' movements. This is going to be the topic of my presentation. And I'm very happy to be here to talk about workers' movements, because usually the mainstream narrative about the uprisings in Egypt and the Middle East has been about a kind of Islamic awakening and never about workers' rights. So we're going to tackle this issue that is quite important at the moment, because even we can say that the 2011 uprisings in the Middle East were leftist movement or workers' revolutions. And this is quite important for us to say that in the four countries, even there are more, I mean, you can say that five countries have been tackled by the uprisings, but let's talk about Egypt, Tunisia, Syria, and Turkey. At the very beginning, yes, there was an increase in Islamic movements, such as the Muslim Brotherhood, but later on, there were many leftist parties and many leftist groups and workers' movements, and especially trade unions, that were starting their activities. For instance, in Egypt, there were these independent trade unions that are quite important now in the political opposition landscape in Egypt. In Tunisia, there is UGTT, that is the Tunisian General Trade Union Federation, that is quite structured and well organized. In Turkey, there is HDP, that is the People Democratic Party, and they had a very important result in the elections last year. And in Syria, as you know, especially in the north of Syria, there is the PYD, that is the party part branch of the PKK, or the Workers' Party in Turkey. It's quite surprising how it's managing in the north of Syria. So let's say that the 2011 uprisings were about leftist ideology and about workers' rights. And even if we talk about that, we kind of have a very different understanding of what was going on in 2011. Let's try to use some of the approaches of scholars. Maybe you heard about them. For instance, Bayat, he was talking about alternative networks, and other scholars, Benin, that was working on workers' movements and strikes, especially in Egypt, And Haniyeh was working about imperialism, saying that all these events that were going on in the Middle East were against imperialism, against the International Monetary Fund loans. And this is especially true if you look to Egypt, that is a country where 30% of the population is living with less than $1 per day. Let's look at the actors present in Tahrir Square in 2011 with this perspective. There were many different protagonists in the uprising in 2011. There were many women, there were many Muslim brothers, but there were many workers, there were many immigrants coming from peripheral areas. There were many LGBT activists. So it's quite very diverse what was going to be, a very diverse crowd was gathering in Tahrir Square. And all those people had very different targets. Some of them were there just to fight against the arbitrary methods of the police, because the Egyptian police, as you know, is quite violent, has been quite violent in previous years, especially in some cases. For instance, Khaled Said, this symbolic young that has been killed in Alexandria, was killed by the police. So we can say that all these people were in the square just to fight against the arbitrary methods of the police. We can say that all these people were against the Mubarak regime, because Hosni Mubarak has been there for 30 years, and his authoritarian regime was quite just going on with this chronic capitalism. But we can say that all these people were there for social justice. And one of the slogans of Tahrir Square was Haish Horeya Wadala Itmahiya. It means bread, freedom, and social justice. So among the targets of all the people that were gathered in Tahrir Square, social justice was maybe the one that could make overlapping interest or common interest. Another slogan was Shabo Rei Deskot El Nizam, the people want the end of the regime. And another very important slogan was El Geish Wel Shab Id Wahda, the people and the army one hand. Because as you know, after a while, the army went to Tahrir Square, and at the end of the day, the revolution ended up with a military coup that started the 28th of January, a couple of days after the occupation of Tahrir Square. This is quite important to say that social justice was one of the most important triggers of the mobilization in Tahrir Square, especially if we look at the strikes and workers' movements in Egypt in that period, because some of the researchers I mentioned, they were counting the strikes going on in Egypt at that time, and especially they found out that the 10th of February 2011, so the day before the Mubarak resignation, there were hundreds of strikes in the major factories in Egypt, especially in Mahal al-Kubra in the Delta, in the factories in Suez, in the Cleopatra factory. So all over the countries, there were hundreds of strikes and labor rights mobilizations. So we can say that social justice was among the most important targets of those very diverse crowd that was present in Tahrir Square. There are other people that were there. For instance, there were street vendors. There were poor people. All those poor people, they were just there, as Bayat would say, because they had connection that were made by the presence in the public space. So all these people were there, and all these antagonists were there and were sharing the same space. If a street vendor is sharing for a long period of time, the same public space with another street vendor, would defend his small rights. For instance, a street vendor would defend his right to take public electricity without paying any bill. And he can go to the Tahrir Square just to ask for that, to defend his gains. And this brings all together, making alternative networks that made what was the uprisings, let's say, that we cannot say that was a revolution, but we can say they were uprisings. What we can say is that in Tahrir Square they were building up alternative networks, but we can argue that those alternative networks were very fragile, and we will see. Close to the major workers' movements, workers' mobilizations, there were the major changes in Egypt. The 10th of February, there was this big mass work is rights mobilization and work is movements and strikes. The same happened at the beginning of 2013 when Mohamed Morsi, the Muslim Brotherhood leader, was the president. And at that time there were hundreds of strikes again. So against the labor movements, workers' movements were mobilizing against the liberalization policies of Mohamed Morsi this time. And there were again strikes and workers' mobilizations in 2014, when after the military coup of July 2013, the president Abdel Fattah al-Sisi began his roadmap and implemented basically his military coup, building up a military regime. Now Egypt is a military regime. And so we can say that close to the major waves of strikes and labor mobilization, there were the major changes in Egypt. So for us, it's more important to look at the factories and what was going on in the major industries in Egypt than in Tahrir Square. And this is quite to rebuild everything on our narrative or our understanding of the uprisings, because the mainstream media were just showing Tahrir Square and saying this is a mobilization of a square, but actually everything was going on out of the square, or far from the square, or beyond the square. Of course, the reaction of the state has been very harsh, and the reaction of the army and of the police together has been very harsh, and they demobilized the movement. How did they mobilize the movement? In many ways. For instance, with rushed electoral procedures, you know that in Egypt they voted six times. With sectarianism, just triggering clashes between Christians and Muslims, with rapes against women, because there was a huge women participation in Tahrir Square. And all these things together brought a kind of very strong demobilization. And let's say that even using the Muslim Brotherhood as proxies, so the Muslim Brothers won the election in 2011-12, and Morsi won the election in 2012 and was president between 2012 and 13, but they really did not have power in that moment. Especially the Muslim Brotherhood government could not do a lot to change or to implement a change or reforms in the Egyptian country. And let's say that the police even, that as we were saying, the policemen disappeared after the first demonstrations and the police itself was very much criticized and stigmatized by the demonstrators, after a while was working together with the army. Even when we arrived to the military coup in 2013, there was this alliance between the army and the police. And the slogan was not anymore El Geshu El Shab Id Wahda, the army and the people are one hand, but was the Shorta will give it one. The police and the army are one hand. So the deep state reacted against the workers' movements, against the labor movements, against the request coming from the grassroots movements, and the reaction was very harsh. And as you know, what happened afterwards in 2013 in Egypt is quite very sad, because there has been a crackdown on dissent, there has been anti-protest law, anti-terrorism law, there has been hundreds of political people arrested, political activists arrested, according to Amnesty International, there are 41,000, hundreds of death penalties, or more than 1,000 in a day. There have been NGOs searched. There is a case against NGOs still going on, and all the NGOs are considered as funded by foreign capitals, and they have been searched or closed, especially those one working on torture and violence against political activists. So Egypt is kind now of a military regime, a crackdown on dissent, repression and mass arrest. So let's say that all this mass mobilization was this mass protest that never became a social movement, that were kind of social non-movements, they were never institutionalized. They never became part of the state, of the working of the state. Let's talk about another actor in all this thing. We just mentioned political Islam and the Muslim Brotherhood used as tool by the regime, but we can talk about the Salafi groups. The Salafi group are the extremists, let's say, Islamic extremists. They've been chosen by the army to mix up everything, to say that the Muslim Brotherhood were all terrorists, they were all belonging to a terrorist organization, and actually there is a very big distinction between Salafi group and Muslim Brothers and the far the Salafists, many of them have been in prison for years, have been used by the army just to stigmatize the Brotherhood. And after, when there was the military coup in 2013, the Salafi group supported the military coup and did not support the Muslim Brotherhood. So just to say that everything was built on this big and strong ties between the army, the police, and the Islamic extremists, so the Salafi groups. A very marginal space was left for alternative networks, for leftist groups. They were all marginalized. They considered as not important in the square. First of all, by the Muslim Brotherhood. And this has been one of the biggest mistakes by the Brotherhood, marginalizing the secular movements that were not taking part in the government. And even other mistakes. I mean, there were too much working on liberalization policies and capitalism. For instance, they did laws for Islamic finance, or the Sukuk, the Kafal, did not look at all at the constituency of the Muslim Brotherhood, the poor people. And the constituency of the Muslim Brotherhood was much more related to middle class people than poor people at the very beginning were part of the movement, part of the constituency of the movement. You know that the Muslim Brotherhood has been working in popular areas, popular local areas, local neighborhood for years, especially giving social, let's say, working on hospitals, working on charities, working on schools. So they were substituting the state. And they lost this part of their constituency, just making things that was helping the middle class. And this is even in the interest of the army, because we were discussing about the factories, but we didn't say that the Egyptian army is the owner of 60% of the factories in Egypt, and in general controls 60% of the economy in Egypt. So when the people and the workers go on strike in the Cleopatra factories, or in the cement factories in Suez, or in the textile factory of Mahal al-Kubra, this is against the corporate interest of the army. So the army reacts just to defend its corporate interest that is coterminous with the corporate interest of the middle class. And it's for this reason that the armies always take over again and again. One of a good example of an antagonist movement, an oppositionist movement, are the independent trade unions, because were the first to be ready to be institutionalized. When there was this law allowing independent trade unions, the EFITU, Egyptian Federation of Independent Trade Unions, and many NGOs related to the independent trade unions, such as CTUWS, Center for Trade Unions and Worker Services, were the first to ask to be legalized. So let's say that the EFITU were ready to be a political group or a workers' movement more than other political parties. Maybe the other one that were ready were the Wasat Center, the moderate among the Muslim Brotherhood. So it's especially interesting to look at the formation of the Egyptian Federation of Independent Trade Unions, and this is still a topic that should be studied more, because they are actually still present in the country, even if they've been infiltrated. You know that there was this movement called Tamarod Campaign in 2013 that was asking for the end of the Morsi regime, and this movement has been infiltrated by the army, that at the end of the day, in this big trigger, this big demonstration, the 30th of June 2013, there were many people in the street, but this was just to justify the July 3, 2013, the arrest of the former president Mohamed Morsi, the military coup, and the crackdown on the political Islam and Muslim Brotherhood. And you know that in Rabah al-Adawiya, hundreds of people were killed in August 2013. What happened with this military coup, and this is, let's say, the second part of the story, that after the military coup in 2013, the effects on many issues in Egypt, but in general in the Middle East, were very strong, and we look at two of them. How the military coup in Egypt increased the effectiveness of ISIS, you know, the Islamic State in Syria and Iraq. You can argue this is not related, or even the events in Egypt are not related with ISIS, but actually they are, because when al-Sisi took over, all the idea that there could be a democracy or more participation in the Middle East was considered as impossible. Let's say that even if someone was asking for democracy in 2011, and we are not sure if democracy was the first target of the demonstrators, maybe the first target was participation, and more participation, but not really democracy, and still they are debating on this point, we can say that after the military coup, the democracy was not on the agenda anymore. more. And if democracy is not on the agenda, let's say that who is going to take over will be an Islamic extremist. And Islamic extremists, for me, are coterminous with Salafi groups. And ISIS is part of this big group of Salafi groups, and they were just saying that when the state is taking over, the deep state is taking over, the deep state needs the Salafi groups to be strong in power and to get stability. Even al-Sisi will consider himself as the model of stability and the model of the fight against terrorism. And this has been done by many European countries and governments. So let's say that all this alliance between the deep state and the jihadi group has been vital for the formation of ISIS. This happened with the alliance between the Hussein regime or the remnants of the Saddam Hussein regime in Iraq with the jihadi group, The same happened in Syria with the alliance between al-Assad and what was going on in the regime, what were the remnants of the regime with the jihadist groups. And it is very important to talk about that. The same happened in Libya, where there was this big alliance between the former or the remnants of the Gaddafi regime and what the so-called ISIS in Libya, even if we don't know if it's that strong or not. So the military coup, so the deep state that comes back in its power, and the state with the police and all what we said together, need the alliance with the Salafi, and this helps the formation of ISIS. Why? Because this kind of state without democracy, without election, needs more terrorism to be in power. Because if there is no terrorism, there is no need to not have election, to not have a free or open democracy or participation of the people. So you need more terrorism, more ISIS to be in power. And this is the, let's say, the idea that has been, and this is against any conspiracy theories, because the relations between the Salafi groups and the state has been proved since the 80s. And so I am always against any kind of conspiracy theory. And if you look at the Sinai, this is very clear, because in the Sinai there is a continuous war, and this continuous war of 1,000 militant of jihadi groups and hundreds of military and soldiers, Egyptian soldiers, is impossible. They never end. If this never ends, because the Egyptian government doesn't want that it ends, because if it ends, there is no necessity to have Abdel Fattah al-Sisi. The second point is that the military coup brought about more migrations and more immigrants. And this is true, because when there was more in Egypt, the Palestinians and Syrians, they were legalized. They have their paper, they had their papers. With the end of the Morsi regime, all their papers were burned, they were not anymore legal. So all these Syrian and Palestinian, especially the Syrians, that were hundreds of thousands, they were forced to go to Libya and after to take a boat to go to Italy, or later on to go to Turkey. And you know what happened at the border between Turkey and Syria, and now the refugees were going to Turkey, and in Turkey there are 2 million of Syrian refugees, etc. And this has been triggered by the military coup in Egypt, because the Syrian refugee could not have any place in Egypt anymore. And this is incredible that afterwards we can argue that even this was built up between, for the alliance between Abdel Fattah al-Sisi and the Khalifa Haftar, that is this general that is controlling the east side of Libya, the Tobruk, part of the Tobruk parliament, and if you want later on we discuss about that. This is especially interesting for me, because I had the chance to go to the north of Syria and to see how a place, this town was called Tel Abyad, was controlled by ISIS, and how ISIS for the people there was not at all an alternative to the state of Bashar al-Assad. And even when you look at how those places have been attacked, on one hand by the international coalition led by the US, and on the other hand by the coalition or by the airstrikes of Russia, you will see that all those airstrikes have never been to overcome the status quo. They have been done just to leave ISIS where it is, to leave ISIS and his position in the country, because Bashar al-Assad needs ISIS to continue to rule. Just to conclude this second part and to go to the conclusions, I would say that to arrive to this point was very important, because if you had a period of opening, how it was 2011, and we discussed about alternative networks, we discussed about workers' movements, how can a military man as Abdel Fattah al-Sisi or Bashar al-Assad or Khalifa Haftar or the other general do that? Such a good job to go back to an authoritarian regime, to a military regime. The idea was to use an ideology that I would call neo-Nasserism, to say that the neoliberalism of the Muslim Brothers has been wrong, all the attempts of the National Democratic Party have been wrong, you are right, you need more social rights, let's have an alliance with the leftist groups, and there were part of them, part of, even the president of the Independent Egyptian Federation of Independent Trade Union joined the interim government in Egypt, Kamal Abueita. Let's say that we need more social rights. But how those social rights will come? Like Nasser was doing, but Nasser was doing, did an agrarian reform, you know, Gamal Abdel Nasser, the Egyptian president after the Free Officers military coup in 1952, he did a big agrarian reform. So let's just bring the name of Nasser, saying that I am the new Nasser, what Abdel Fattah al-Sisi said. This is Nasser without, Nasserism without Nasser, because he didn't do anything like Nasser did. It just did more state capitalism, the extension of the Suez Canal. They found this gas facility in front of Port Said, Zone 9, and is dealing with Eni in Italy, and etc. They want to build up a bridge with Saudi Arabia, a lot of money coming from Saudi Arabia. This is his idea of neo-Nasserism, or let's call pseudo-neo-Nasserism. That is quite the way in which the Egyptian army had a chance to go back to power and to say that they are defending the worker rights, but actually they are not. They are cutting subsidies, they are doing state capitalism, and not nothing more. But they are not popular as they were in 2011. Because if I said at the beginning that in 2011 there was this people and the army one hand, this is not true now, because the people know in Egypt and in many other countries that the army killed a lot of people, killed people the rabble other way, etc. And when they went to the elections in 2014-2015, the percentage of people going to vote was kind of very low, 25%, 20%. So the people is not anymore as it was on the side of the army. So what we can say, and another point, and here I don't need to just to emphasize this, is that you don't need just neo-Nasserism, you need even xenophobia, and the way in which they left Syrian people going from Egypt is just because they were using chauvinism, saying we don't need those Palestinian are coterminous with Hamas, they are all belonging to the Muslim Brotherhood, so the two key things is neo-Nasserism and xenophobia. What we can say to conclude is that the 2011 uprisings in Egypt and Tunisia and the uprisings in many other countries in the Middle East and North Africa could have been a proletarian revolution. And the subproletariat was among the most important actors of the revolution in the very beginning, of the movement in the very beginning. And the leftist group were marginalized and co-opted in part, especially their leaders within the regime, in the Egyptian case within the regime of Abdel Fattah al-Sisi. But we can say that these workers' movement are not over, because now there are new strikes, hundreds of them. The Egyptian Federation of Independent Trade Union are still working. The PYD in Syria is very strong. UGTT in Tunisia won the Nobel Prize and is very strong as well. HDP is in the parliament. So let's remember the 2000, let's talk about 2011 uprisings in the Middle East as a leftist revolution. Thank you.
Thank you, Giuseppe. If there are no brief demands for clarifications, I will move the floor to our third member of this panel, which is Aleš Mendizhevac, who will focus on ISIS. Aleš is a student who is completing his PhD studies focusing on Althusserian political philosophy and epistemology. He publishes journalistic and theoretical articles at Radio Student and at Shoe Magazine and elsewhere. And also he is a member of the collectives of Neteorit and Živko Skotec. And to complete this CV, I would like to issue a statement of apology on behalf of the program collective for the typo which you are witnessing on the screen. Now, my consciousness is clear, and Alash, the floor is yours.
So I guess I will move the topic a bit towards Syria, Iraq, and ISIS, but just let me explain at first that my discourse will be a bit different. I'm not like my colleagues here, I don't know, a historian that would know much about the history of Middle East or Northern Africa, nor am I a theologian who would have broad knowledge of Islam or other religions or religion in general, and nor am I a full-time investigative journalist who would follow in detail the latest events or be even on the terrain. My position was much more simple. I was simply someone that was at one time reading some literature on political philosophy on modern epistemological basis of the so-called Western society, and by pure coincidence something that someone calls different history of Islam. I was reading all of this when the so-called the rise of Islamic State happened, and that rise of Islamic State stunned me from this point of view. And it really did stun me in a way in strict this epistemological context, because ISIS at this time was known. The radical Islamist organization who now wants to establish a fully developed state on totally new grounds has been known and has been in action for some time. For example, the videos of the beheadings were already notorious and spectacularized by media, as were the destroyings of ancient temples and artifacts of great cultural heritage and so on. And for example, the analysis were also being made, like their successful military tactics, the Turkish economic collaboration with them, the financial support from the Saudis and the like, and the increasingly more complex situation in Syria, and all the interventions that my colleagues here described. For example, Patrick Ogburn, in his book The Rise of Islamic State, if you read it, it is a really nice journalistic work. He does this, and he mainly demystifies the rise of ISIS in terms of their strategically brilliant accomplishment, which became notorious, and he dissolves this myth into complex geostrategic processes that were partially here already described. But what I found interesting in this book that at the end he concludes really interestingly. He becomes a bit more subjective, and he ends it with some sort of blaming conclusion that ISIS could have been easily stopped. There were a lot of factors that were not hard to change. And here he points his finger mainly at the US, Saudi Arabia, and Iraq. But nothing was being done. Nothing had changed. They weren't stopped. So now they are in a position, which I think is a unique position, when they have their own state, namely our state that they even want to establish, and that they have a position to build a lasting modern state. They even conquered the territory where they exercise this power and try to establish a system of government with all of its fears, sectors, rules, and so on. For example, Al-Qaeda was never even close to this, despite their notoriety. After 9/11, they were just, how should I put it, they were never a homogeneous group with a clear political orientation that is needed to build a state. They were mainly particular reactionary terrorist acts. And the term Al-Qaeda, as Patrick Cockburn nicely demonstrates, is as something homogeneous was a notion that was constructed by the US. And that ISIS was at first the Iraqi subgroup of the Al-Qaeda, which then was separated from them and is now in clear conflict with them, only testifies to this thesis. So, ISIS's power and position in this aspect can be seen in their power to establish their own name. They've called themselves and the world and everyone else follows here, the Islamic State. And this is exactly what stunned me. They pronounced themselves as a state, and everyone just accepted this. So they were in a position that they got the power to do such a thing. And what really intrigues me here is that they call themselves a state, that this is primarily a political notion and not theological. Of course, we can they mean this state as a sort of a caliphate, but and this is what, the way, in a way, the words Icelandic state in its Sunni version means. But they did not explicitly name themselves a caliphate. They chose the words state. And I think this is not just being, I don't know what, it is important, I think, to notice the specific use of words, because it shows their way of thinking, their, in a way, their episteme, if I may borrow this rather wide concept. But we will come back to this later. What is important here is that ISIS considers themselves as a modern state, and I will consider them as such. So if one is interested in political philosophy, then this must be at least a little bit intriguing or stunning. The rise of ISIS as a state is, to put in Marxist terms, a primitive political accumulation. First, the conjunction of some original territory, which the Westerners dismembered with the notorious Sykes-Picot agreement as the final cut, which Micha showed the relevance of this. And the second, the constitutive gathering, or rather regathering, of the scattered elements of original universality, some sort of volonté générale, if you will, an origin lost and blurred in the present, the past which must now come to life. So we could bear this, we could bear witness to this phenomenon when Guardian published ISIS's leaked documents, naming them a master plan for consolidating power. So now we know just how serious they are. They really intend to build a state that will last. And Islamic State is not only a declared state. They want to, and to some extent they already did, establish a proper state with all of its apparatuses, institutions, with developed administration, educational system, healthcare system, economic investment and state-organized economic productions, and so on. And all of this shows ISIS's ideology. It outlines not only the principles of governing of their territory and strategy for becoming a viable state, but foremost its conditions sine qua non. Its ideological basis is a social unity on which different systems of government can be articulated. So I really want to stress this, that the ideological basis that it is that ensures the cohesiveness to this state and society of ISIS. So it is not of primary importance whether this means monarchic, democratic, or aristocratic rule. The governmental differences are important, but what is essential here is the common basis on which they are articulated and differentiated. So, and when one tries to establish a new state, this is exactly what comes to the foreground. And ISIS papers start exactly with this, the declarative act of establishing a new state in a form of announcement. They have by then already conquered most of the theologically original territory for the state, the Syria and so-called Levant, which is one of the names actually. So this state was dismembered as a consequence of Western interventions, which culminated in the notorious Sykes-Picot agreement. And this is the reason why ISIS emphasizes so much the theological meaning of territories and cities like Raqqa, which is of great eschatological importance to them. And territory in general is not just land or oil for them. It is theologically important origin as a basis for social and political unity, which will in its turn accomplish a lasting return to this origin, namely the state. So the conquering of the territory is described in the introduction of ISIS papers. I quote, "It was inevitable that there would be an organization of these numbers of mujahideen and their principles as a Shari organization, accepting the current reality that the world marshaled against it from its soldiers and intelligence services," end of quote. And we can see here some sort of clever interpretative twist. What was a product of so many failed Western interventions, or for ISIS, so many fortunate encounters and coincidences that gave birth to them, is being here understood as something inevitable, as necessary regrouping of scattered Islamic individuals, mujahideen, into some original universality, here understood as Sharia, being this ideological basis. But this is not yet Ummah, the so-called Muslim community, here understood as a Muslim nation. The society, the strict core of society, the cohesiveness must yet to be built. And just how to do that? Before answering this question, it is important to notice that this declarative act, which is also a constitutive act in its intended consequences of regathering these Muslims, is directed inwards and outwards. Inwards towards Islamic Mujahideen as the inner ideological basis of the state, which is entirely theological, and outwards against everything that is not a part of theological ideology, which means basically everything Western as non-Muslim, and even Shia as other Muslim, which means for them basically non-Muslim. And this outward direction is entirely militant political direction as a reaction to the Western past and present interventions. And this, I think, is crucial in understanding ISIS, this intertwining of militant politics and radical theology. And we cannot even separate them, as I just did, to inward and outwards, outward direction. They condition each other, and the primary notion here is not theology. Theology is not is not the ideological basis, this is primary, that the inner relation turned outwards toward the world as a necessary relation to the other, but it is rather the other way around, that that their necessary relation of exterior world to exterior world as a militant reaction to political interventions moves to the interiority of ISIS's ideology as theology. We can see this in the second chapter of the ISIS paper that I mentioned, entitled Organization of Individual and Group. With the birth of state, and the necessary step now is to fortify the ideological cohesiveness and homogeneity of their society, and this is supposed to be realized in the so-called camps, they use this word, camps. And the purpose of these camps is to assimilate non-Arabic with the local Arabic population, because Arabic language is the language of Quran, and in this manner the basis of this articulation. And this is why they teach all at this camps Arabic language and the radical doctrine of Islam, the Salafis, Giuseppe mentioned. But also they must engage here in between these teachings in some sort of physical activities in order to be physically prepared. And for example, they have to run into push-ups before they go to Sharia lesson. And later this activity, this is, I don't know if it's here be seen as with such importance, but quite quickly these activities become militarized, and not only the physical ones like firing guns and so on, but also theological teachings. For example, hadiths, the sayings of Prophet Muhammad, which are the second most important reference for Islam, have the function here of, I quote, direct administration, end of quote, which is described in chapter 4 of these ISIS papers, which means that they use the hadiths for guidance of Mujahideen before and after combat for the purpose of obedience to authority. And even Arabic language has some sort of militant twist. Besides that being the language of Quran, the real importance, maybe even the most important function for ISIS is being a unified code of communication without which military missions are just impossible. So this militarized Islam is the ideological basis that ties together the ISIS society. While the whole administrative organization of the state follows from this, the people who are in charge of administrative functions, who are in position to make decisions and to give orders, are just this Mujahideen, but the best Mujahideen, the cream of the crop that were trained in these camps. So this means that political positions are filled with outstanding militants, which are the basis of their society. So bottom line here is that there can be no citizens. There are only militants, only military, and excellent military as politicians. And this is how the militant direction towards the outside dimension turns into the essence of the inner life of the inner society and political organization of ISIS. And we see the same picture if we turn to economic policy. The main income of ISIS is not oil and gas, which represent only, I think, about a quarter of total income. About a half of the income represent confiscations and acquired war assets, So half of their income is, again, of militant nature. And the last quarter represent taxes, which have a tricky operative, which operative basis is again militant, because they range from about 15 to 75%, and the strict decision of precise quantity here lays in the hands of militant collectors and momentary whims. And the other factor being here religious, for example Christians and others who manage to stay alive, pay much more than Muslims for being these others. And on the side of state expenditure is still the same. A lot of their bigger investments are of militant nature, for example, building of a transportation infrastructure with the purpose not to build the conditions of the economic market, but for improving military movements and its efficiency. As for the quantitative side, two-thirds of the expenditures represent military salary and the maintenance of the military establishment and infrastructure. But my aim here is not to describe the whole political and economic problem, because this would be quite impossible. There are not good enough information to do something like that, to do some complete analysis. My point is rather here to show the ideological background, the cohesiveness of their society, the core, which is militant Islamist reactions, reaction against Western interventions, turned to the inner essence of their state, as we've seen. They are strict reaction in a strict sense. They are the other subordinate side, which tries to turn around this hierarchy of subordination with being just like the dominant side, the Westerns, only in much more excessive way, hence their brutality. Their attempt to build a state functions as a return to the origin in exactly the same way as a theorist of social contract would have it, the theorist of the essence of the Western state, if I may put it like that. ISIS relies on the origin, on the ideological universality that was lost or blurred with Western interventions, and this origin is purely mythical, just like, for example, Rousseau's Volonté Générale. ISIS does not explain what this origin consists of. They do not elaborate their own foundation, they merely declare, each time that they refer to some originality, they declare it. They merely appropriate the origin, whether it is Quran, Ummah, or Muslims. And they appropriate it in an ideological level with this empty declaration. And because this mythical origin was itself blurred, dismembered by the Western interventions, the restoration of them and the origin of their origin can be achieved only with a violent reaction against these interventions. The difference between nation and religion here does not play an essential role, because religion here functions almost as a sort of a nation. And I must here emphasize that it functions in the same way, because the content, of course, is totally different. Salafi ideology has the same function here as this national ideology, both being identities, universalities conceptually derived out of the concept of origin. Not only politically, as we have seen, but also theologically. And this is not coincidence, because ideology is something coherent, it is a systematic thought. The political project of returning to origin is a part of the modern episteme. The empty declarative return to origin is one of the main aspects of modern way of thinking, and if we relate ISIS to that, it isn't coincidence that their theology functions in the same way. Thomas Bauer excellently demonstrated this in his book called The Culture of Ambiguity. One of the main interpretative acts that constituted modernistic Islam, according to Bauer, is the interpretative twist of the status of Quran. In classic Islam, Quran was, of course, the main reference point, as always is, for Islamic studies, but it did not represent for them an original writing, the direct transmission of God's words, which were being written. Rather, it was a written version of verbal origin, as verbal teachings. But verbal teachings cannot have an origin, because it is transmitted through people which comprises psychological and generational obstacles. In fact, one cannot even state that verbal teachings are original, but that written Quran and verbal teachings are synchronized on the same level of importance, on the same level, maybe not on importance, but this means that Quran cannot be a written origin, but a common basis for different verbal teachings. And Bauer proves this with showing that the writing in the first standardized version of Quran, which was being done by Uthman, is intentionally missing the diacritical signs, and this is what enables different pronunciations, different meanings of certain words, different teachings, and different legitimate interpretations. And this is crucial that different interpretations are can be at the same time legitimate. This means that the written Quran is not definitely univocal, but that some statements are necessary and intentionally left ambiguous, which demand comparative study between statements in Quran and also Quran with the Hadiths. The modernist version of Islam, and with it the Salafi ISIS, fail to see just this point. They take all of the statements for univocal, for transparent, containing only one possible meaning, which is original. But from this point of view, they merely inscribe their own presuppositions, their own way of thinking into all the possible meanings of a certain statement, erasing these multiple possibilities. And this is why they can only declare and not explain the original meaning, in strictly the same way that they can declare Quran as an origin, and that they can declare that they did declare Islamic State as a state on the basis of territorial and ideological origin. And this is how their ideology functions, with empty declaration of the origin as legitimation for everything. This is why their Islamist doctrine can and must be inscribed in every aspect of life, and not only as universe, but also as the absolute, the only aspect of every aspect of life. And it's not a coincidence that their Islamic law infiltrates into the most banal aspects of everyday life, like prohibition of smoking in one of the most cigarette-loving countries, or prohibitions of on fashion accessories, breeding pigeons on the rooftops, and other absurdities. Their outward direct hostility shows itself here as a harsh strictness on the interiority of their state. The reactionary nature of their movement is in this way inscribed in their inner essence of society and state. So when the Western interventions provoke the violent reaction of modern Islamists, we get ISIS, a violent excessive state with its militant politics theology being inscribed in every pore of social life. Instead of reason, we have a Salafi God. Instead of war as politics, there is politics as war. Certainly, their political organization is different from the modern state, understood sociologically. And their social essence and religion are not distinct, as in the modern state. But its essence, its functioning of this essence, is in the same way as we've seen. They try to establish a modern state on the basis of the Western political philosophy, on the foundations of social contract. The difference here is that they are a reaction, a force that was provoked by the other to its existence. And this is why ISIS ISIS is a specific version of the West with its state, an excessive state politically and socially. So here comes, I think a question comes to mind, is this excessive state durable? And I think I will end here.
Thank you, Alash. And with this, we conclude the introductory presentations and move on to the general discussion. We actually have a good half hour, if it really carries on. The rules of the game are the following. We shall do it consecutively, meaning question and answer, question and answer. You may address your questions to the respective panelists or just throw them out generally. General comments also, of course, appreciated. Please await for the microphones in order to do so. Are there any questions? Or, as per tradition, will the panelist be the one who has to start with the breaking of the ice? Of course, it shall be so. I would actually begin with a hard one. If we talk about organizations whose political program is the retraditionalization of society, and there's a whole spectrum of them, from very militant ones, such as, I don't know, Hamas and Hezbollah, to more moderate ones who have experience with actually being in formal power, such as the Muslim Brotherhood in Tunisia and Egypt, or Erdogan's party in Turkey, or of course ISIS, which I guess is a combination of both. Which of them would you say are the most successful in terms of embeddedness in society? Which ones have the most popular support, or at least are the most successful in facilitating social peace? in order to carry out their programs? I guess it's a question to all three panelists. And again, sorry for a hard one.
So for ISIS, I guess, I think that they are not, their policy here is not successful by itself, but it is actually successful as a product of other conditions, as foreign interventions. For example, the local people in Iraq, when in 2014, when they established themselves as a state, for example, the local people were left to choose between the radical Sunnis, which were the ISIS, and the Shia government, which was being run by al-Maliki at the time. And the governmental policy here was just, okay, let's fight against ISIS on some point, but this fight against ISIS was being actually a fight against the Sunni in general. So they didn't have a problem if they hit a building when they were just Sunni civilists and radical Sunni ISIS. So this is one, I think, major factor why a lot of people support, local people in a way support ISIS, even because the alternative is even worse.
On this we can make a point, saying that of course the Muslim Brotherhood is much more embedded in the society, especially in Egypt and Tunisia, than other more extremist groups as ISIS or jihadist fighters, etc. As you know, the Muslim Brotherhood has been always rewarded by the regimes, by Gamal Abdel Nasser and later on by Anwar al-Sadat and by Hosni Mubarak. So there is always a kind of repression and concession to the Muslim Brotherhood. So we give to them something, or they can reach the parliament as independents, and later on we make a crackdown on them and we close their activities. At the moment, all their schools and hospitals and NGOs, especially the management of their NGOs, are the people are in prison or they are just removed from their places of work. So let's say that three years ago, the Muslim Brotherhood was in power and the president was a leader of the Muslim Brotherhood. So this is always the structure of the relationship between power and the Brotherhood. It is repeating itself since 80 years, let's say, because even in 2005, there were 88 members of the parliament that were Muslim Brothers, and still, after a while, there was a crackdown on the Brotherhood. On the other thing, and as I mentioned before, ISIS had not at all control of the society in the places where they were. We had the chance to talk to people in the north, the northern Syrian towns, and they were saying, we are forced to pay for the hospital facilities just to have doctors and medicine and stuff, and because ISIS was a government at that time, and we didn't do the same when there was Bashar al-Assad in power. So ISIS has never been considered as rooted in their traditions. For instance, there were other people in Tel Aviv saying, arguing that they did not allow them to pray in the street. And this was quite amazing for them because they used to pray in the street. So ISIS was even against their religious traditions because they were too strict for them and they didn't understand their way of ruling. On ISIS and the previous presentation, and I'm very happy because it was good and interesting, just I would say that the Sunni-Shia divide, because always we talk about ISIS saying there is ISIS is considered a Sunni, and after there is Shia, and Iran is the Shia country, etc. And we make a nuclear agreement with Iran, so Iran is stronger, and so there is a kind of balance of power between ISIS and Iran, as if Iran was kind of belonging to these groups. Let's leave this to the mainstream media. Let's say that this Sunni-Shia division has been, sectarianism, a way in which they portray the Middle East, has been overimposed with war in Iraq in 2003, and we don't have to look at ISIS in this way. We have to look at ISIS considering the relationship between the deep state in those countries and the jihadi groups.
Okay. As I still see no hands, I would like to follow up on this dynamic that Giuseppe was now briefly mentioning. My question is actually Do you think that we are overemphasizing the role of foreign military interventions in what is happening currently in the Middle East, precisely because of the scenarios which I mean, to mention a few, for instance, this policy of the al-Maliki regime in Iraq of throwing Sunnis out of public office, for instance, al-Assad in Syria releasing extremist political prisoners for years now, the military establishment using the Muslim Brotherhood as proxies in Egypt. All of these are dynamics of the political scenarios now unfolding in the respective countries. So, as opposed to what I just described, do you think that here in the West we are overemphasizing the role of the West in general? Yeah, I guess again throwing to all three. Well, we can start from the right and move to the left. So, Giuseppe.
What can I say? Of course, I'm against all kinds of foreign interventions in this in the Middle East and countries and North Africa. Especially, I consider a disaster what they did in Libya with the NATO interventions in 2011. But let's look another point. Let's look another way. Let's talk about the U.S. position and the U.S. interventions, not only military but politically. And let's talk about Barack Obama and the way in which this administration triggered the 2011 uprisings and if it was effective or not. It was not effective at all. As you can, if you think about 2009, he gave his speech, Obama, in Cairo University, saying we need democracy. And this speech was about democracy and human rights, etc. And after when there was the uprisings in 2011, let's say that there was this perception that the US government was supporting the Muslim Brotherhood or even was giving them the chance to be the government. But after, when there was the military coup, they left the Muslim Brotherhood to themselves. They didn't do anything to support the first elected president, Mohamed Morsi, in Egypt. But so let's say that it's quite schizophrenic the way in which they were acting in the Middle East. They were not sure, they were just reacting to things that were going on in the region. And really, really, I guess that's is amazing what they did in Libya. Because in Libya, they were supporting the Muslim Brotherhood. The Libyan Muslim Brothers were much more linked to the jihadi groups, so to the extremists, Islamist extremists. And when they won the election in 2012 in Libya, you know that there was this big attack to the US consulate in Benghazi, and Chris Stevens, the ambassador, was killed. So after a while, they understood that the way in which they were managing the political relations inside these countries were detrimental for their interest. And Hillary Clinton has been charged, and she discussed a lot about that. This is one of the most important points because she has been considered as not effective in their foreign policy. Let's say that even the US ambassador Ann Patterson met with Mohamed Morsi when he was in power in Egypt. So in general, the politics of conflict, politics of war with the US in the region has been completely wrong. Even if you look at Syria, the way in which they were fueling the Syrian oppositions, they were giving money to those groups that after a while those arms, weapons and stuff went to Salaf and to jihadist group. Now they were considered different. Al-Nusra compared to Al-Qaeda and after a while to ISIS, and all these weapons went to ISIS, etc. This is a disaster what they did in the Middle East. But I don't consider that Russia was doing better, as you know, because with the attacks in Syria and ISIS still working in the country, we cannot say that. We can only say that Putin intervened when the US is lacking in its foreign policy. And the only good position of Russia is in the Turkish-Syrian conflict. As you know, that Turkey is fueling ISIS in Syria, and the Russian intervention and the way in which Putin stigmatized, the way in which the Turkish government is fueling ISIS, giving them the chance to bring weapons within the Turkish government. This is the only good point of the Russian foreign policy. Thank you.
And to my left.
I would like just here to emphasize the importance of a distinction between what are the demands of the masses of the people and what are the decisions that are being done by organizations such as ISIS, for example. I think that the Sunni and Shia difference is on the for the masses, if I put it like that. I think it is really not as important as it may seem, as Giuseppe later before mentioned, that their demands in social movements are more democratic, bread and social justice and I don't know what else. But when ISIS thinks that Sunni and Shia divide is important, they make it important because of their because they are an important factor in the regional happiness.
I mean, by all standards, the war in Syria is a proxy war, so I don't understand quite the question if we are overestimating the influence of foreign powers. Does it mean in the sense of its impact until now, or it's in its prospect of the same, or as a possibility of ending the conflict? Because I think it's not so much whether or not foreign powers are interfering, it's just the question of transparency and to some degree of some joint operation, but I think joint operations in this sense, if you're asking in terms of politics. But I think it is impossible to look at this conflict as a Syrian conflict since the very beginning, since I think the majority of ISIS members ISIS is a foreign intervention by itself. Majority of its members, I understand, not native Syrians.
Okay. Any more questions?
Okay, I have just a quite short question for Giuseppe. One thing I learned from your presentation, I wasn't quite aware earlier, was that this transition in Egypt from Muslim Brotherhood and then after coup was also a transition between, let's say, neoliberalism and then later more state capitalism. And yeah, I was a bit surprised that the Muslim Brotherhood was, to describe it as, that this actually neoliberal, so I wonder, is it just a proper ideological point of Muslim Brotherhood, or is it more like a just spontaneous adjustment to the geopolitical situation, just going with the flow, or is actually, yes, something, I guess, ideological, is there an ideologically coherent explanation behind it?
Yes, let's say that it's correct to say that it was a kind of transition between the neoliberalism and state capitalism, even if state capitalism is implying neoliberalism or entails these kind of policies. What we can argue is that the Muslim Brotherhood have been depicted as terrorists or as extremists, but basically are just conservative, and they do right-wing policies. This is more or less the way in which we look at the Muslim Brotherhood in Egypt. And so we can add that they were just following the path that was already established by the National Democratic Party, because the NDP, the party of Mubarak, was always doing these ways of liberalization. There were liberalization in 1975, there were liberalization in the end of the 90s, there were liberalization in 2004, and after all these infita policies, open door policies, there were strikes, because of course the workers were fighting for their minimum wage, for their social rights. So let's say that the Muslim Brotherhood were just following the policies of the Mubarak regime. For this reason, many oppositionists, many leftist groups and leftist movement, revolutionary socialists, Sikhs, etc., they were arguing that the Muslim Brothers were counter-revolutionary because they were against the request coming from the grassroots movements. Even within the trade unions, they were just co-opting people from the National Democratic Party that would be sold, so they were using them to work in the trade unions. So let's say that the Muslim Brotherhood were not a political and economic alternative to the previous regime, and of course the military regime and Abdel Fattah al-Sisi is not again, because they are doing the same things with more state capitalism, so main big works and stuff, but not social policies.
Over there to the left.
Yes. A question maybe to all the four of us, but especially to you, Giuseppe. I agree with you a lot when you say, discussing the issue of Western intervention, that most of the US interventions have been totally unfortunate. And if we look back in the long term, like over decades, one has the impression that the US has caused a lot of detriment to other countries without any advantage for themselves, and how much detriment they would have spared to themselves, for example, if they had not removed the Mossadegh government in the 50s in Iran. No? So one is justified, I think, as to claim, as you did, to say the US have to be protected from themselves in the first place. But on the other hand, I think if we look at what is happening now in Syria and Libya, is it not what we observe here, and I just want to problematize the notion of Western intervention here. Is this not a new type of imperialism which we should call post-colonial imperialism? It's not like in modern times, in colonial imperialism, that you try to occupy some territory and dictate the political ruling forces and stabilize it against some other foreign enemy. But on the contrary, that you are by principle just interested in the destabilization of the territory and in the permanence of the ongoing conflict. So I had for years the impression that in Syria, the US does not want any side to win. The biggest advantage was just that, I don't know, Hezbollah shoots against Al-Qaeda. That's the wish fulfillment for the US. No? And I think, so in order to compare the US intervention and the Russian intervention in Syria, I would say this is a war of destabilization against stabilization, or it's a war of post-colonial imperialism against colonial imperialism, if you want.
Yes, of course,
I fully agree with your point. And even when you look at ISIS, the way in which ISIS was working, and we can say that ISIS was trying to destroy the Sykes-Picot agreement that were previously mentioned, as considered as overimposed by colonial powers, and of course we are considering all these as a post-colonialism, post-colonial wars. But on this instance, I would like to quote what is going on in Libya, because I think that is very important, because now you know that there is this unity government, GNA, the agreement government of al-Sarraj, Faiz al-Sarraj, and he's trying to have his power in Tripoli. And he asked for a foreign intervention, especially to the United Nations, to protect the oil terminals. So even now is directly the government imposed by the United Nations asking for an intervention. So we are completely in a post-colonial era where the world is needed for everybody, is needed for, in this case, the Libyan case study, we can say that the US wants it. Even the US is pushing Italy to be part of, to lead the coalition of the UN coalition in Libya. The French government is already doing that in Tobruk, in the eastern side of Libya, and the UK is doing the same, attacking with these drones. So let's say that the war is already there, and is even is the unity government is asking for protecting the oil terminal. This is quite interesting, because the militia, you know that in Libya there are many militias, and the militias are controlling the oil terminals, and the Mellita one is the most important, and Ibrahim Jadran, that is the leader of this militia, Petroleum Protection Guard, has been injured. So of course the Prime Minister doesn't know how to control the oil terminals, and he's asking for a foreign intervention for doing that, because he cannot do that. So we are really in a moment where all those countries became failed state. Libya is a failed state, Syria is a failed state, and everybody wants that things going on continue to go on like this, because a failed state can be maybe better controlled than a strong state. And Egypt and Tunisia, we can consider them a strong and centralized state that reacted to this kind of very strong foreign intervention in the country, if you want to look at like that at the mobility, at the dynamics, political dynamics in the region.
Thank you for the comment. I think we have time for at least one or two more questions over there in the center.
I would like to ask about what actually Giuseppe and Aless were talking about. So this is a percentage of military in the kind of national economy. So basically what most of the colonized state up to Pakistan did after they gained independence was that they simply just took this colonization model of army. So you have an army which is like five times too big for your country and is basically doing the police job as well. So it's not meant just to protect the country to the outside, but also to kind of preserve this status quo. And basically, maybe you could just like talk about this, because like what Aless was addressing as a really as something special in the ISIS economy. So this enormous percentage of the of foundings going to military and for military, and what Michal was also expressing several times about Iraq, that you have a lot of these Peshmerga, which are at the moment, of course, not being paid as well, is also the case in Egypt. And if you could just like maybe tell a little bit about this militarization process that is a constant thing in the country.
Let's say that when we mentioned that in Egypt the army is controlling 60% of the economy, we can say that the army is controlling the most important factories, bakery factories, milk factories, all the tourist industry, all the factories doing refrigerators, everything for the house, and everything. They control schools, they are the management of the most important companies, in the board of many companies, especially retired officers. So they have a strong control of the Egyptian economy, and especially of many of the companies. Even when they were working with the National Democratic Party, many of the leaders of the National Democratic Party had a military background. So the point is that until the 2011 uprisings, there was a kind of overlapping leadership. So the military elite and the political elite were coterminous, were the same. Anwar al-Sadat was a soldier, Gamal Abdel Nasser was a soldier, Hosni Mubarak was a soldier, and you never had a divide between the civilian elite and the military elite. The only moment in Egyptian history where you had this was with Morsi, and they didn't want that for long, so it just lasts for 1 year. And after now, you have a complete overlapping military elite with political elite. The way in which they try to distinguish themselves from the political elite has been strong, has been important for Mubarak, because at the end of the day, you even didn't remember, you didn't know, or at least you forgot that Mubarak was a soldier, and this was the secret of the Egyptian army, to be in power, but let's say to depict themselves as out of power. But now there is not the case, because when al-Sisi was going to Suez and was going to celebrate for the extension of the Suez Canal, was wearing his military dress. So let's say that the overlapping between the military and political elite came back. Even another thing is that usually there is a distinction between all paramilitary groups that is quite strong. So you have the Shorta Laskaria, the military police, you have the Amn al-Dawla, that is the secret police, you have the secret military services and the civilian military services that are distinct. But in this moment, you cannot say that there is a strong distinction between all these groups. Let's say, in other words, that in Egypt, for a long time, someone was looking about a fight inside the army, within the army, with some soldiers that maybe were against al-Sisi, let's say. We can quote Sami Anan, that wanted to go to power after a while and wanted to participate to the presidential election. Even we cannot exaggerate that. So the army at the moment is very homogeneous and is supporting al-Sisi, and there are just marginal oppositionists inside the army. And this opposition came from the young soldiers. Many of them, they were supporting the movement in the square. Many of them, they were supporting the Muslim Brothers, because there are many Muslim Brothers inside the army. And even you have a politicization inside the army, because there were many supporting Karama, let's say the left wing or the neo-Nasserist groups, not the pseudo-neo-Nasserism of al-Sisi, but Hamdin Sabahi, that was the other leader of the opposition and leader in Egypt. So let's say that there are distinctions between paramilitary groups, and there is political distinction within the army, but the control over the economy brings them all together just to re-establish or restructure the overlapping, let's say, structure of power between the political and the military elite.
Okay, last show of hands for the final question. As I see none, I would kindly thank all of our panelists for their contributions and also for their attendance.